Hello everyone, this is Nithin Sridhar here. For those who don't know me, I am basically a civil engineer by training, but now I am a journalist, an author, and presently I am editor of India Facts, the popular Indology platform where we publish articles on Indian history, Indian culture, traditions, etc. I would like to first thank Indic Book Club and Swarajya for giving me platform to speak about my book. And so today's session will be basically I'll be speaking about my latest book, Musings on Hinduism. The book was published 2 months back in March by Rare Publications Chennai, and it gives an overview and introduction towards Hindu religion, philosophy, etc. But before that, I would like to speak a little about my life journey. As I said, I am by academic training, I am a civil engineer. I finished my civil engineering in 2010, and I was in construction field for 5 years till 2015, when I changed from civil engineering into journalism. So many people have asked me why, why did I make this jump? Because engineering, writing, or journalism, they are not at all connected. So the real reason was that I have always loved writing. I mean, since my high school days, I used to write then various essays, stories, limericks, etc. But as I evolved in my writing, I realized that I'm more into writing objective essays. I mean, analyzing things and research essays, such kind of stuff. I remember I opened my first blog and when I was in engineering or something, Yahoo 360. I don't know how many of you even know about it. Even while I was studying civil engineering, I used to write for Pioneer newspaper and Vijayvani.com and few other portals. I was encouraged by many people when I was in Orkut, those Orkut old days, when I was very new to this writing, especially professional writing. I was encouraged by Surjit Das Gupta, who is today editor of Sirf News. And because of a lot of this encouragement, I continued writing. But after 2010, when I finished my engineering and I started my job, that was the time when my writing came to a standstill, I can say. What was previously 1 or 2 articles a month reduced to, you know, just I could write only 1 or 2 article between 2010 and 2013 or something. So there was a dissatisfaction within me. I felt that I did not belong to the civil engineering, and this civil engineering was not suitable for me, because I did not feel a fulfilling. So in 2015, when I got a chance to jump, and there was a job opening for staff writer in Newsgram, I took it and I came to journalism. So this was the, you know, career wise my journey, and that is why today I am writing. And but I must share one thing, that when I say writing, I do not mean any kind of writings. For example, I don't write usually on travel or cuisine or any such stuff. For me, writing, when I speak about writing as my inner calling, or as something that is very close to my heart, I specifically, you know, refer to the kind of topics I deal with. For example, I write on social issues, on religion, theology, especially Hinduism. To be more specific, my writings are usually around Vedanta or the concepts of Dharma. I try to analyze current social issues from dharmic perspective. So it is these kinds of writing where I feel completely fulfilled. It was in response to my inner calling that I came to writing, I came to journalism, I became an author, I wrote this book. This is my book, Musings on Hinduism. I'm sure many of you already know. This book is basically a collection of my writings, many of them essays, many of them blog posts, some of them were, you know, compilations from my Twitter posts. Most of them were written in a spontaneous manner, and these are my musings on various aspects of Hinduism and Hindu philosophy. So if you so look at the very first page, I have this photo of Jagadguru Shankaracharya Sri Bharatitirtha Mahaswamiji of Sringeri, and I consider him as my guru, and he has been the most inspiration and guidance behind all my writings, all my journey, in fact. Of course, I would like to, you know, clarify that he is not a Diksha Guru. I have not got any Diksha or something from him. Just like a million others, I am one of his Shishya. I consider him my Guru. But yes, I have felt his presence. I have felt his guidance in every endeavor I take. And I owe everything to him. And in the second page, you will see a painting of Ganapati. And this is a very, you know, special form of Ganapati. It's called it's a Tantrika Ganapati, wherein Ganapati sits on a row of skulls and he holds a bowl of blood. You might ask why this specific form when there are hundreds of other forms. I think I was very attracted to this form from the very first time I saw it. It's based on a sculpture, in fact, found in Java somewhere. My attraction is more to do with how I am, you know, the two images in a sense also reflect the fact that I am I feel very home in both the path of Vedanta as well as the path of Tantra. I feel very comfortable in both. These have been my influences, the Advaita Vedanta especially, as well as the Shakta Marga. They both have been very influenced in my spiritual journey. And I think if you read through this book, you will see those influences clearly. And regarding the content of the book, I think the book is divided into different sections, thematic sections. The first section is on Hindu religion and philosophy, and I would add that the at least four or five essays in this section, they are the direct result of my reflections after the series of lectures delivered by my guru Bharatitirtha Swami. He had done a Vijay Yatra in 2012 and delivered a few lectures on Vedanta during Chaturmasya. And after listening to them, making notes and reflecting on them, few essays like Two Paths of Life, Two Ways of Performing Action, Two Stages in Devotion, these are all directly based on those reflections. And in the first section, you'll also find my section, chapters on Tantra, on the position of sexuality in Hinduism, and such related stuff. And the second section is fully dedicated to Vedanta, and in this section it is not you will not find a in-depth analysis of Advaita Vedanta as such, but the purpose of this section is to clear some of the very basic doubts that a new student of Advaita or Vedanta faces. And I have done it in a very easier, accessible manner, using anecdotes, examples, and such things. For example, there is a chapter here on Vedas, a valid means of knowledge. That is one of the basic questions. Why should we take Veda as a Pramana? And there is a chapter on Jnana, Bhakti, Karma. I mean, these three are the three pillars of Hindu Dharma, but often we perceive them as three separate independent paths, and there is a lot of debates and discussions out of it. And I have tried to give an integral over wholesome view wherein they are not three different things, but they are connected and how they are connected, etc. And you will find many such chapters in this Vedanta section about what Maya is, what Advaita means, etc. And there is a, after that, there is a short section on Hindu society, wherein I analyze some of the problems troubling our society today. And I try to give out my analysis of what is the root cause and how we could rectify it. And then for the serious readers, serious students of Advaita Vedanta, In the next section, there is my English commentary on Nirvana Shatkam, and there are other Sanskrit translations of few hymns like Saraswati Ashtotar, which people may find interesting. And finally, in the last section, it's a miscellaneous section, it's a miscellaneous collection of my writings. It has some chapters like importance of Gayatri Mantra, what is the symbolism of Shivalinga Puja, etc. So these are the many things the book speaks about. If you ask who this book is, who is the intended audience, I think it is both those who are new to Hinduism. It may be Hindus themselves in India, or it may be foreigners who are discovering Hinduism, but who are new students. And it is also for those in the intermediate levels of study of Vedanta, where they may have certain questions. So it is even for a serious scholars, serious students of Vedanta and Hinduism, certain chapters like the two stages of creation, the two aspects of creation, these two stages of bhakti, or my commentary on Nirvana Shatkam, they may find this interesting and useful. So this is my short introduction to my book and of course my life journey. And since this is an Indic chat, so I'll be taking questions, of course. So now you can write your questions as comments. But before addressing those questions, so please start writing the questions as comments. I have already got few questions beforehand from some of my readers. Some 6 to 7 questions are there. So I will take those questions first. And after that, I will address if there are any more questions in the comments. So the first question that I got few days back in Twitter was, please elaborate on karma. Does belief in karma make people insensitive to others' suffering? Does it create an attitude like you deserve it? And is it bereft of compassion? I think this is a very wonderful question, because there are a lot of confusions regarding karma. People have a lot of misconceptions about how to understand and how to practice this karma. Let me state, karma does not mean insensitivity. Karma does not mean defeatist attitude. What karma means is, it is not telling it, of course it is saying that there are people often have this character or this tendency to blame everybody for their misery. They blame God, they blame government, they blame everybody else. Of course, we should point out the mistakes wherever it is, but we should also realize the fact that our suffering somewhere down the line is due to our own previous actions. It is our choices that decide the outcome that we face. So the karma says that what you sow, you reap. So whatever situations you are facing in life today, the sufferings, it may be happiness, it is all based on your previous actions. But that doesn't mean that we are slaves of fate, because we also have free will. In fact, fate and free will are not two contradictory things. In fact, they are the two aspects of the same coin called karma. So the gist of the karmic understanding worldview is that we have a free will, we have a choice to how we react to life situations. That choice is with us in the present, and by doing the right choice, we have a choice between what is right and what is easy. This choice, how we apply this choice, decides the outcome in our future. What we face happiness, sorrow, it is all depends on how we act in the present. So this is the correct way of understanding karma, that we need to act. We need to act in a righteous manner so as to make our life meaningful and fulfilling. So coming to this insensitivity part, yes, it is true that people are suffering because somewhere down the line it's due to their own previous actions. But this does not mean we are to become insensitive. Instead, whatever Hindu Shastras say, Dharma Shastras say, there is a concept called Samanya Dharma, the common duties for all human beings, irrespective of their nationality, sex, gender, all those things, race, etc. irrespective of that, there is something called a samanya dharma, common duty. And among the things that are advised as common duty, satya, asteya, etc., there is something called daya as well. Daya is compassion. So you are bound, you are obligated to be compassionate towards others. You are obligated to be compassionate, especially towards those who are not as privileged as you. So when we see others, what do our shastras say? Instead, far from being asking us to become insensitive to others, it is asking us to show compassion, not pity. There is a difference. We just need to show compassion by recognizing the fact that, see, he is also suffering from, he's suffering due to some his previous karma. Yes, but we are also going through the same stages. So there is a bonding. So let us help them if any way we can. If we cannot help them, at least let us be compassionate. Let us not think bad about them. Let us not be insensitive towards them. I think this is the right way of understanding karma, and this the karmic worldview. I will not say theory because it's a worldview. It's a reality. We may accept it or not. This karmic reality, instead, in fact, makes us more sensitive to others' suffering. If when understood in a correct manner. And the second question is on Varnashrama. Another person asked me, is it fixed or is it fluid? What is the essence of Varnashrama Dharma? I think this is a very huge topic. I will not be going in depth into this because it's a huge mind. And there are a lot of confusions, lot of misunderstanding, misconceptions are there regarding Varna. I will simply say that Varnashrama is one of the most unique contribution of Hindu Dharma when correctly understood. Varna basically means to choose our Swadharma based on our Swabhava. Swabhava is our temperament, our inner calling. Swadharma is our duties, our personal duties, which are unique to us. I already spoke about this Samanya Dharma, which is common to all. There is something called as Vishesha Dharma. They are tailor-made duties for each individual based on their inner calling, based on their capacities, competencies and temperaments. A duty of a scientist may be different from an engineer. Duty of an engineer may be different from a soldier. It may be different from a labor. It is all different. And this is not limited to being scientist or job description. It is also limited to the whole life. To understand Varnashrama properly, we need to understand where is it coming from? What is the basic thing? What is the source concept on which it is based? It is based on the universal vision of Sanatan Dharma, which is in fact encoded in the word Dharma itself. Dharma means to uphold. What does it uphold? It upholds the entire universe. How is it uphold? How does the entire universe is upheld? By making sure it envisions a grand universe wherein each individual is able to pursue their path of inner calling, pursue their self-actualization, leading ultimately to moksha. We have this framework of purusharthas, dharma, artha, kama, moksha. Most of you are aware of these terms, so I will not explain them. Dharma is righteous duties, and artha or kama are material pleasures, wealth, prosperity, and moksha is ultimate liberation. While moksha is the ultimate goal, our immediate goal in this life, we may not be competent enough to pursue that moksha directly. We may not achieve it. So what is our immediate goal? It is dharma or swadharma, practicing our special duties. In the West, they have come up with a concept of Maslow's pyramid of needs, where they speak about, they make a pyramid. At the bottom is physiological needs, then safety, etc. And finally, there is something called self-actualization. If we superimpose it on our pyramid of Purushartha, we will find the self-actualization is nothing but this Swadharma, the purpose in our life. So this Varnashrama, the universal vision of this ideal society that is Sanatana Dharma speaks about, it is to allow each individual, each person to follow the path, their own path to self-actualization. These are the core of all the diversity in India we see at different levels. So this path of self-actualization may be different for different person based on their different temperaments and different aspirations. they are divided into Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. This is a general division, general guideline. This is a kind of archetype. But our practical society is a completely different thing. I think there have been a lot of misconceptions, lot of colonialism, and even due to the effects of Kali Yuga, lot of misunderstanding have crept up. This is caste system which we speak about today, the caste identities, they are political identities. They have nothing to do with Varnashrama as such. Even the Jati, the way Jati is understood by Manusmriti is very different by how Jati is developed in the last 1,000 years. Since last 1,000 years, Jatis and Kula, they have become intermingled. They are more related to guilds, the trade guilds, etc. But that is not what Jati Manusmriti speaks about. It speaks of a completely different thing about the Swabhava, the inner temperament. So this is a very complicated concept. In short, to answer if whether Varnashrama is fixed or fluid, as far as the individual is concerned, it is not. It is both fixed and fluid in the sense it is not same for everybody. Each has a different, their own unique path to self-actualization. The paths may be similar but will never be same, because different people will be at different stages of spiritual evolution, overall evolution, dharmic evolution instead. But for a particular life, this because our temperament, our what we the how we develop our swabhava, it's more or less same since our birth. It's based on our previous karmas, it's based on the genes we inherited from us, the swabhas we inherit from our parents. So our paths are more or less, our temperaments are more or less same. Of course, it can be changed by individual effort, by exertion of free will like Vishwamitra did, but it is a very difficult, but it is possible. But before that, we have to be perfect in what we do. Like that is why Krishna says Swadharma Nidhanam Shreya. So we need to perfect our Swadharma. We need to find our inner calling and perfect it before, moving forward. So this is a journey. This is a journey for many lives, not just for this life. And the next question is, why Musings? What is the significance of title? Would you have given the book a different title? This question was asked by my good friend Shubhadeep. Many others have also asked why I have given the title Musings on Hinduism. Well, musings means reflections, etc. As I said, the most of these writings, they were not written to make it into a book as such. They were written more as a reflection of my own inner journey, my own journey from being an atheist in my high school to being a practicing Hindu today. Practicing Hindu, I define it as someone who is not just a Hindu politically or culturally, but he is also practicing Hindu in a dharmic sense. He tries to understand his Swadharma. He tries to fit himself in this universal vision of self-actualization and Purusharta and pursue his own Swadharma. So the writings, many of these are a direct result of my reflections on my study of various shastras, my journey as a Hindu, as a Sanatana Dharmi, and many of them were in fact written as a on the spot, a spontaneous reactions, a spontaneous reflections on some issues which were triggered in social media or some news or something like that. So that is why I thought it is best to give the name Musings instead of something else. And then the next question is the word God same as Brahman? God with a capital G, is it same as Brahman? If not, should we not stop using the word God to describe? I think it's a very good question. I think ideally speaking, yes, we should use Brahman. And yes, we should use Ishvara, etc. But deep down, I also feel since I write in English, I communicate mostly in English, I'm speaking to the audience which are well-versed in English, I think we cannot completely, wipe out the word God, at least now, not now, because many people are not aware of the significance of the term Brahman, what is its meaning, or even of Ishvara. But to explain them, we need to provide some anchorage, which is got by the term that they are familiar with, the God. In India, though this term God has a Christian connotation, the creator God, etc., and we do not subscribe to that. Yet in India, even the English-speaking class, the liberal, the left, etc., they may not always define this God as a Christian God. They may simply understood as a ultimate reality. I have come across many who understand God as simply as ultimate reality. To them, using a word God and then explaining Brahman and what is the meaning of Brahman in Vedanta and Hindu Dharma, or what is the meaning of Ishvara, I think this helps. And that is why in my book I have used the term God at many places, but I have also used Brahman extensively. Ishvara also to some extent I have used. And another question is, what is Hinduism? Explain about Dharma. I think I just explained about two questions back about the universal vision of self-actualization of Purusharatha, the Moksha, our Swadharma. This is a huge question. This is a never-ending question. So I will not again elaborate it now. Moving on to the next question. Who is your inspiration? Well, there have been many inspirations for me, and I already spoke about how my guru, Sri Sri Bharatiya Tirtha Swamiji, has been one of the most inspiring figure in my life, at least since 2013, because I was not aware of him. Of course, I knew that he was a Shankaracharya, but I was not aware of his teachings. There was no connection then, before 2013. But since 2013, I have been intimately connected to him. I feel the inner connection with him and his guidance every moment of my life. So I will say he has been the most greatest inspiration in the last few years. And the next question is, what projects are you currently working on, and what are your future book projects? Well, currently I'm working on a series on abortion. Part one was already published, and on another three parts to go. I have written the whole thing. So this is the current project I was working from last, I think, 4 to 5 months. I think from January I am working on that, and I have finished it. It just remaining to be published. The first part was published on India Facts, and I am working on. Last year I had written a series of articles on called Hindu View of Menstruation. Delhi publisher had approached me and requested me to expand it into a full-fledged book, and I am currently working on that. Hopefully, I aim to finish the first draft by the end of the year. There are a lot of research to do, but I aim to finish it this year. And I have few other projects half complete or in different stages. Since 2013, I have been working on a commentary on Isha Upanishad, but it's still the first draft is complete, but it needs a lot of revisions, which I am yet to do. And recently, I started writing a short commentary on one of the works of Adi Shankara, but it is beyond the first mantra. I have not gone beyond. So there are many other pending projects like that. So these were some of the questions that I had got on beforehand before starting this session. And now I would like to take questions if any have been asked in comments. So please put your questions in comment section, and I would take them. I think I have one question by Somashekhara Nimbalkar. Question is, not sure if it is appropriate here, feel free to not answer. So the question is, Shiva as a reproductive symbol, how correct is it? I don't feel it is. Can you discuss the below forward? It is a phallic symbol surrounded by yoni, ejaculating milk, Rudraksh, scrotum, etc. I think I have extensively written on this topic, Somshekhar. In fact, in the book itself, there is a chapter on the symbolism of Shivalinga worship. And recently, I wrote an article on India Facts. There is, excuse me, there is nothing wrong in worshipping phallus. Without going into details again, because you can find them in those writings, I would simply say this linga has many meanings, mark, symbol, these are the meanings as well. But of course, phallus is one of the meanings, and each meaning has their own relevance and context. The context of this Shiva and Shakti, Yoni and linga in a sexual aspect, the context is there are the material physical manifestation of the cosmic union between Shiva and Shakti, the universal male and feminine, the Purusha and Prakriti. But what is the relevance in practice? I think that relevance is very limited to certain tantrika sadhanas, wherein the male counterpart identifies himself with Bhairava and the female with the Bhairavi. And apart from such sadhanas or some linga puja and yoni worship, this interpretation or this view, this meaning of linga as phallus, it is not relevant in a mainstream worship. In mainstream view, there is concept of mukhalinga, where the linga is the face of the Shiva. And of course, the Shivalinga is three bhagas, Rudra bhaga, Brahma bhaga, and Vishnu bhaga. So, as I said, this there is a relevance to this phallic meaning, and we don't need to reject it, we don't need to feel ashamed of it. But it has a context, it has a meaning, and I would request you to go through my article in India Facts, as well as my chapter in the book. And another question I have is from Pankaj Saxena. Did Voice of India play a part in your transformation from being an atheist to practicing Hindu? In fact, it did. I did not become from atheist to Hindu practitioner overnight. It was a slow process. And I first became a political Hindu, actually. How did it happen? It was basically triggered by the publications of Voice of India, I must say, by writings of Sitaram Goyal, Arun Shauri, and Ram Swarup, to name a few. And especially when after Godhra, Gujarat, and when the facts came out, how it happened, how the left cable tried to, you know, create a false narrative. That was the trigger when for the first time I realized that I am a Hindu by culture as a political identity, even though I may not believe in God, I may not believe in Hindu Shastras. So that was the intermediate stage before I plunged deeper into the practicing the dharmic aspect of Hinduism. And is there any other questions? Let me scroll and see. Mayuresh says, excellent book that explains fundamentals. Thank you, Mayuresh. Ramesh says, it is very interesting. Thank you, Ramesh. Thank you, Malaji, for all your wishes. There is one more question, I think. This is from Kedarnath Shastri. He asks, could you please explain the concept of Punya and Papa according to Hinduism? Is Papa equals to sin according to Christianity? Hello, Kedarnath. This is a very good question. Let me straight away say that Papa in Hinduism is not equal to sin in Christianity. Christianity has a concept of original sin, and the concept of heaven and hell are permanent places of torture or pleasures. This is nowhere related to how Hinduism perceives concepts of Papa and Punya. Papa and Punya is deeply related to concept of karma. As I said, if you do dharma, it results in sukha. If you do adharma, it results in dukkha. So this dharmic actions is punya, gives punya, the merit. That merit in turn causes results in happiness for us. So why does dharma, performance of dharmic actions lead to happiness? Because it gives spiritual merit, which is called as punya. And this performance of adharma gives demerit, which is called as papa. A related topic is about the Swarga and Naraka. Many philosophers have spoken about how this very world, our sufferings itself is Naraka and our happiness itself is Swarga. Yes, that is also valid. That is also true. This plane is of course a loka where we take birth to face the fruits of our actions. But there are also different realms like Bhuva, Suva, Loka and other Lokas. There are also realms where, like Narakas, the Puranas, the Smriti speak about different Narakas. They are all temporary realms, temporary births where we take to face the Narakas, especially they're temporary realms where we wipe off the fruits of our most heinous of the crimes. We face the punishment there. Of course, you may feel this as funny, and we actually don't know how exactly this happens. Only when we face it, we will know. It may not be the way the stories in Puranas portray, that these stories have symbolic and deeper meaning of certain aspects. But it is there, that is what matters for us, because we cannot see it from our eyes. Similarly, the Devaloka, the attainment of a comparatively immortal condition compared to earthly life, it is called a Swarga, and lot of have been written in the scriptures. But even that is ultimately a temporary entity, temporary existence. We return back to earth, and that is what makes our Hindu Dharma concept of Punya and Papa very different from Abrahamic concept. So the next question is, let me see. Shekhar Malik asks me, by any chance have you watched Star Trek, the TV series? It is more purist than Star Wars, etc. It's more geeky and has many Sanatan Dharma concepts. If not, please do watch. I have watched Star Trek, the new series of movies, though not the serials. But yes, I think a lot of Hollywood movies, including Matrix and even the Star Wars, they have some concepts which are very similar or which have been inspired from Sanatan Dharma. And yes, I am familiar about that. My only issue is such concepts are not explored within India itself. And I think many of them have that complaint from Indian film industry. And second question from Shekhar is, do you think Ishwara might be an alien after all? I think I do not subscribe to such view. I feel it is very funny. I think it is simply shallow. It lacks deeper reading of understanding the concept of our devatas, concepts of our Ishwara. See, these different realms, Bhu, Suva and Mahaloka, these are not different planets in our physical universe. When Bhuloka is said, it does not refer to just earth as is translated often. It refers to entire physical universe. So the alien in a stricted sense, the way we understand that aliens are some species of different planets. No, I do not agree that Ishwara or Devas are aliens. But if you take a dictionary meaning, like saying even someone who is from a different country can be an alien. That is, there's different species or different kind of beings. In that sense, yes, devas are different beings, but even the jiva in us, we can become devas by doing upasana, karma anushtana, and there are a lot of many other things. And next I have a question from Jijit Ravi. Hello Jijit. The four ashramas, Brahmacharya, Grihastashrama, Vanaprastha and Sannyasa has a sequence. Do Purusharthas, Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha imply sequence? Do Varna, Shudra, Vaishya, Kshatriya, Brahmana have a hierarchy or sequence? Very fantastic questions, Jijit. In fact, I exactly believe that there is a correlation between all those things. It is not a haphazardly created worldview. They are all related. For example, in one of the Smriti, there is a statement. I would caution, before taking the understanding Smriti statement, it should be understood as a guideline, not as a literal pen writing. Okay, so in one of the Smriti, there is a statement saying, Shudras have adhikara to only one ashrama, that is grihastha ashrama, while Vaishyas have adhikara to two ashramas, grihastha, brahmacharya and grihastha, whereas Kshatriya have adhikara to three ashramas, brahmacharya, grihastha and vanaprastha, and only brahmanas have adhikara to four ashramas. As I said, these brahmana kshatriya, they are all the temperaments, they are all the swabhavas. Of course, swabhava is related to birth, but it is in a different way than we currently understand today. I will not go into that. But the thing is, why are they correlated? It is because who is a Shudra? The tradition understands it as one who is materially outlook. His outlook is mundane. His outlook is their family. Basically the Kama and Artha, especially the Kama. The Kama also means how to fulfill our small desires, how to lead day-to-day lives. So they do not have the means or even the time to think about higher things, spiritual evolution or the doing sadhana. They don't have time. We have stories from, Bhagavad Purana and all, how a potterer, when Narada asks him, how do you worship? He says, in the morning I take his name before starting my work, and in the evening I take my name, but I don't have any more time to take anybody's name or to do worship. So this is the kind of Shudra, because they don't have time, their life is already full of many concerns, many challenges. So that is why they have only grihastha ashrama, because they do not have dispassion and they do not have time or competency to practice Veda Dhyana as well. Similarly, for Vaishyas, they have brahmacharya because they are the economic backbone of the society. They need to have their mind in control. Because they need to have their mind in control, they have to do certain amount of, small amount of Veda Dhyana, practice the kind of Upadesha they are given, the kind of mantra they are given in Upanayana, so that to keep their mind strong and controlled and restrained and not to exploit others. Similarly with Kshatriyas and others. So there is a correlation. This is not a strict correlation. There may be individual exceptions. There may be lot of individual exceptions. This is a general guideline. So similarly, this I think that answers the question. Where was the question? I lost the question. Yes. Yeah. So brahmacharya, grihastha ashrama, vanaprastha on one hand, the ashramas, and then on the other hand, purushartha. Yes. How is the Purusharatha related? In the Brahmacharya, the dharmic teaching is given. The concept of dharma, our Vishesha dharma, our Samanya dharma, our day-to-day dharma, how do we behave, what is the whole universal vision of Sanatana dharma is taught to the students. That is why dharma remains, it corresponds to Brahmacharya ashrama. Of course, dharma is always there. But in the Grihastha, apart from dharma, this artha and kama also comes, and I think vanaprastha and sannyasa we can combine and we can correlate to dharma and moksha, because I think that would be better, because vanaprasthi he has left his duty as a householder, but he is not fully overcome his desires. The purpose of vanaprastha is to provide a cushion time between grihastha ashrama dharma and this sannyasa, and not everybody is able to achieve sannyasa in this life. And the next question is DV says he likes the bit size chapters and simple explanations. Thank you, DV. Dimple says, ask me, how long did you take to write your book? As I said, I did not write it as a book. It is a collection of my writings, various blog posts, various published articles, various Twitter and Facebook posts, which were written between 2007 and 2013. So it took, 5 years, or in fact 6 years. And one more question from DV. Do you think dharma as you explain it will survive the current onslaught by the adharmic religions? It looks a grim battle to me. If I have to answer it from the Hindu worldview, we speak in the terms of yugas. We have the four yugas: Satya Yuga, Dwapara, Treta, Dwapara, and finally Kaliyuga. And we are in Kaliyuga. And what our Shastra says, it compares the Dharma to a bull with four legs. In the Satya Yuga, Dharma stood on all its four legs. In Treta Yuga, one leg was cut due to rising Adharma and it stood on three legs. And in Dwapara Yuga, another leg of Dharma was cut due to more rising Adharma and the bull stood on two legs. And in Kali Yuga, it's one more leg, but still it stands on one leg. So I think despite the grievous times, the very problematic times we are today, the challenges from Abrahamic religions, the challenges from all the various forces, even though we are still at the beginning of the Kali Yuga and there are million hundreds of thousands of years left, and the things will get more worse and worse, not better, over time, still I think Dharma will stand on one leg till then. Because if Dharma is completely destroyed, if there is complete adharma, then there will be pralaya, and we are very far from pralaya as far as I am concerned. So I think we will be able to overcome adharma, adharmic religions, because after all, what our Shastra says, dharmo rakshati rakshita, and yathas dharma tathas jaya, right? So I think Dharma will sustain all the attacks, and I intuitively feel in the coming decades we will see a reversal of happenings. We will see a revival of Dharma. I think we are already seeing a revival of Dharma in some ways, in some sections, like in media, in some sections. The fact that we are all here together speaking about this book, it's also a sign of how things are turning around. And Anjali says, have started reading the book, very informative and insightful. Thank you, Anjali. Nikhil asked me a question about Devanagari. I'm sorry, Nikhil, I don't have an answer to your question because I have not done any research regarding how the Devanagari evolved and where it went on. So I am unable to answer your question. I think these are all the questions. Please let me know if you have any more questions. This is a time to let me know any more questions if you have. If there is no question, I think I can. Yes, Dimple asked me, when is your next book coming? I frankly don't know, Dimple, when it is coming. I'm working on it from last 6 months actually, and I hope to finish it by the end of this year, the first draft. So hopefully somewhere next year, maybe May, June, July, I don't know exactly. Hopefully next year the book will be published. Thank you, Sumedha, for your wishes. Before ending, I would like to thank again Swaraj and Indic Book Club for giving me this opportunity to speak about my book, to connect with my readers, answer their questions. And next week, next Sunday, Indic Chat, you will be able to connect with Mayuresh, my very dear friend Mayuresh Didholkar, and his book The Dark Road has just been published. It has been published by Jaggernaut, and you can all download their app and read the book. And he needs no introduction, everybody knows him. He writes articles for India Facts, he writes articles for Swarajya and many other platforms. And of course, I would like to add that as an editor of India Facts, I would like to welcome all of you to send your articles if you have anything related to India, Indian history, Indian culture, religion, etc. I welcome new authors. We give a platform to new authors. One more question, I think, from Shekhar. The Buddha avatar and Gautam Buddha are different. Your knowledge, view on this? I don't know about whether they are different or not. In some traditions, Buddha is not even counted as an avatar. Instead, Balarama is counted. But in some traditions, Buddha is also counted of as an avatar. Intuitively speaking, I don't have any basis, but I think Buddha was one of the avatar, since considering the way the enormous contribution he has made. Some are positive, some may have been unintended negative consequences as well. But I like to believe he was a very influential figure, and that could not be possible without him having been a partial avatar at least. Just as we consider Adi Shankaracharya as an avatar of Ishvara as well, and which I firmly believe in, since I belong to that sampradaya. But even otherwise, I have firm faith in that. So I think I would end today's session. It was a wonderful session as far as I am concerned, and I'm very happy to have answered all your questions. And if you have any more questions, you can ask me here in this Facebook. I am on Twitter as well. My handle is at nkgrock. You can ask me anytime. You can write to me email ID. It is sridhar.nithin@gmail.com. So I hope you people enjoy my book, and do get back with your feedbacks. And of course, don't forget to write your feedback comments on Amazon, because it helps to reach more and more number of people. Thank you.